Yes, we are back. We're live, 2 o'clock rock, here on Community Matters, and community does matter. With Roger Epstein, he's a tax attorney of 45 years and here in Hawaii. Or five of those were with the Internal Revenue Service.
Plus 45 years.
Plus 45. Well, let me do the math on that. Whoa.
I think that's 50, Jay.
Okay. Yeah. You heard it here on ThinkTech, 45 plus 5. Okay. And Gavin Thornton. Gavin Thornton is the co-executive director of the Hawaii Appleseed Center.
That's right.
Yeah,
thanks
great,
for having
great
me.
Great to have you here, you guys.
Yeah.
Now, what's happening is we have a legislature in session, and we have a bill. Let's call it the Hawaii Tax Fairness Bill. And let's talk to you, Gavin. What does that bill say?
Sure. So what that bill does is it tries to even out the balance in Hawaii's tax system. Right now, Hawaii's low-income earners pay a much higher percentage of their income towards state taxes than the folks at the highest ends of the income scale. This is trying to change that balance by really doing a couple things. One is updating some existing credits that are already on the books, the food credit, the renter's credit, which hasn't been adjusted for 35 plus years, so since 1981, probably when you were breakdancing.
I can't remember those
when
days.
When he was born.
Right
when
ahead.
He was born.
and so, of course, we've had massive inflation since then, seeking for the value of that credit to go from $50 to $150. We're also seeking to adopt a working families credit, which would bolster the incomes of working families. It has broad bipartisan support across the nation based off of the federal earned income tax.
So this
credit
is not limited to Hawaii.
Well, this particular package is, but the working families credit that we're proposing here is based off a federal credit that's already been in existence for many years, that's recognized as being the most powerful tool to fight poverty.
Yeah.
And so we're looking at adopting a state counterpart, which 26 other states in the nation have already done, and we need to do it here to balance out the system. And then to pay for those things, and also to help with that balance, we're looking at reinstituting the tax rates that were in place on the highest earners in Hawaii from 2009 to 2015.
You're changing the brackets.
Changing the brackets at the high end, yes.
Increasing the tax at the higher end.
Yeah.
Not just changing brackets, the tax rate would be higher.
Oh, so the bracket, the percentage bracket remains the same?
And then there'd be brackets that have a higher tax rate when you have more income.
Okay. First, what is the Appleseed, why is the Appleseed Foundation, or rather, Center for Law and Economic Justice, why is it interested in this?
Sure. Well, we're, Hawaii Appleseed is really interested in ensuring that we have a Hawaii where everyone has an opportunity to achieve economic stability and success. And one of the main ways that we've identified to be able to do that is by addressing some of the unfairness in our tax system. We have people that are struggling to make ends meet. We have the highest housing costs in the nation, highest cost of living in the nation, lowest wages in the nation.
When you
factor in the cost of living, a terrible combination. And as a result of that, 50% of, actually 48% of families are struggling paycheck to paycheck. And so we need to figure out a way to deal with that. And one of the best ways to deal with it is simply stop taking money out of people's pockets through a really regressive and oppressive tax system.
Mm-hmm. Just going to cost us, I mean, us meaning everyone, is it going to cost money to put this program through?
Well, the great thing about this particular package is that it's revenue neutral. It doesn't cost the state anything. Now, definitely the folks at the higher end of the income scale will need to step up and pay a little more. But right now, the people at the low end are paying such a higher percentage of their income. Over 13% of their income goes towards state and local taxes, whereas on the high end, it's about 8%.
Yeah, that sounds regressive to me and unfair to me. You know, Hawaii has the gross excise tax, and you told me earlier, Roger, that half of the revenue to the state comes through the gross excise tax, maybe a little more because of the surcharge on rail. That's regressive. That's not fair. And we've had that for a long time. This is something we need to correct, don't you think?
Well, one of the things, I think we're in a revolution for taxes. Because of the new administration, because we're likely to see... In Washington, we're likely to see federal taxes go down. One of the arguments that the Republicans always make is that, well, everybody should pay some tax. In Hawaii, half the money that funds our government comes from a tax that people who make, say, $40,000 or $50,000 a year are paying 100% of their income at 4.5%. It's all spent on food, on clothing, on
rents. Very regressive.
Very regressive and very all-encompassing.
Yeah.
So if you're making $500,000 a year, you're not going to spend all that in a general excise tax manner. Maybe you spend 50. Maybe you spend 100.
Right.
But the percentage of your income that you pay the general excise tax on much higher for people in a lower bracket. So when I talk to my friends who are Republican and having practiced law with the largest law firm in the state here for 45 years, all my friends are Republicans.
That's why you're not practicing law now.
I've retired. I retired last June.
You found the truth, yeah.
I did. And now they can all be mad at me. But the main thing is we're looking at a situation that to me is a perfect storm. You're going to have the federal government who is going to cut back on social services. So the state's going to have to pick that up, or we're going to have even more homeless people, houseless people. And if the federal tax goes down, which is supposed to, then there's going to be money freed up, so to speak, for the wealthier. Now, the beauty, nobody likes to pay taxes. 50 years in the tax world, I never met a person who wanted to pay taxes.
You heard it here on ThinkTech.
Including me. But the truth is, unlike what Ronald Reagan said, that government is the problem, it's not the answer. In my mind, government is people getting together to say, how do we pay for things we need to do?
It's our government, isn't it?
So it's not redistribution of wealth, it's who's going to carry the freight for the services that we need to have in the state, including fixing the streets, and what do we do about the homeless, and what do we do about the working poor in our state? So the beauty of a state tax is when the wealthier pay the state tax, they get a deduction for federal purposes. So in a sense, the feds are giving us some of the money through...
Because we have the wealthy paying the tax.
So for example, if a wealthy person is in a 40% bracket, we don't know what the new brackets will be for federal, let's say 40%, he pays $10,000 in state taxes. He gets a reduction, he gets essentially a reduction of $4,000 from the federal government.
Right.
So in a sense, the federal government paid us $4,000.
That's the way it's been so far.
Right.
We hope that continues, no?
Well, if the tax rates federally go down to 15% that the Republicans have talked about, when somebody pays $10,000, the federal government's only paying $1,500 now, not $4,000, because the brackets will change.
Yeah.
But my point is really, if the feds say, we're not giving you as much money, and you raise the taxes at the highest level, then you're, in a sense, getting something from the feds that they took away from you on the other side.
But what I get from you is that we have this social safety net problem in Hawaii, a lot of features to that, a lot of factors, a lot of reasons, a lot of effects. It's a major process, phenomenon, happening here for a long time. And even before Donald Trump was elected, even before this recent election. And it would have been appropriate in the years past, dealing with that, to have this very same bill, right, then. But now we have Donald Trump. Now we have changes that are going to happen, probably going to happen in Republican Congress, to reduce tax burden of the rich.
I want to suggest something else that's coming along. You know, all the years I've been in industry, 20 years ago, we changed a system that's just going to start kicking in now about pensions. So pensions used to be, when I retire, I get 35 or 40% of what I make. That's called a defined benefit plan. We don't have that anymore. We have 401k plans, which are defined contribution, which means whatever you put in, that's all you get. And many people, I think the average across the country is like $125,000. So you retire at age 65, people are living longer. In Hawaii, we have the longest lived people in the country. They're going to live for another 25, 30 years on $125,000.
They won't have enough money.
Not going to happen.
And they'll be poor in their elder years.
And what they're going to do is people are going to start working part-time jobs. And this kind of credit will keep them from having to take that additional income and pay more tax. Whereas the guy on the higher end, Hawaii has a wonderful thing that I'm not talking about changing. We don't tax pensions. And we shouldn't, because we're going to have more people on shorter pensions.
Yeah.
But the people who come here in Hawaii, and if they have the rate of their income tax raised, but they've excluded all of their pensions, it doesn't seem to me that you could complain that, oh, Hawaii's got these really high income tax rates now. So you've got a couple of things going for you. Pensions are exempt, so that's a real credit, a benefit to people on pensions, including the wealthy on pensions. Mm-hmm. And now you've got a federal tax that may go down and less distributions to the state, so more need for revenue. If you apply a state tax at the highest levels, those people are getting a benefit from the feds, so it's balancing out. They're only paying essentially 60% of the additional tax, and the federal government's paying the other 40%. For the people who get the credit, they're at the low income, so they're not in the 40% bracket. They may be in a 15% bracket, 20%. So the credit doesn't cost them as much. In other words, the rich guy is getting a federal tax reduction. The poor guy doesn't get a federal tax increase because he probably wasn't itemizing his deductions anyway.
Sure.
And in any event, he's in a lower bracket. So it really works to the state's advantage without hurting the wealthier people as much. And the wealthy people are always already getting this huge break that most states don't do.
Yeah.
They're not tax pensions.
So it's really a confluence of things.
Yes.
It's the way the system works here with the current unfairness, which has been evolving for a long time. And it's the federal system, which is going to change. We don't know exactly how, but we got the direction on that.
Yeah.
And it's the interrelationship of the two systems right now. And you said before that this was a revolution. We are in, you said.
I think
a revolution in taxes. And what I get from that is, and it's about time, that people really pay attention to what's going on and how these three factors work and how they work together, and take and speak on it and try to get it rational and try to get it to comport with what our society is doing.
Yeah, and I think that's really true. And the communication, the discussions about it are very unclear. Like if you say to somebody, well, you're in a 40% bracket, that doesn't mean you're paying 40% of your income. That's just on income over X dollars. I think the Fed is $350,000, and our bracket is $350,000. So unless you're making $350,000, you're not going to have additional tax cost. But it doesn't. If you are in the 40% bracket, your overall taxes may be 20%.
Yeah. I hope you're writing this down.
But what anyway, I meant by a revolution, Jay, we got to look at the way the world is. In the 60s, the federal government started picking up a lot of costs because of the civil rights. They started taking over more responsibility.
And the national social safety net.
And then they did it in education, human services. Now we're going to see a cutback. And so it's states' rights.
Yeah, and we've been talking about this. We've been talking about this for the last few weeks, about how this cutback, these changes that Donald Trump has promised us and is regrettably following through on, require the state to be resilient and to figure out a better path for itself.
Right.
And on that very point, I want to take a short break. We're going to come back. We're going to talk about this path in the legislature, and what you're doing, Gavin, and what you're doing, Roger, and the hearings and the likelihood of success and who is helping you. I want to know about the politics right after this break.
You're watching ThinkTech Hawaii, offering lifelong learning from passionate hosts and fascinating guests ready to explore and explain Hawaii's place in the 21st century. Great content for Hawaii from ThinkTech.
Aloha. My name is Reg Baker, and I'm the host of Business in Hawaii with Reg Baker. We broadcast live every Thursday at 2 o'clock. We highlight businesses and individuals that are successful in Hawaii, and we learn their secrets to their success. I hope you can join us and listen in, because we always have a pack of information on successful stories in Hawaii. Aloha.
Hello, I'm Marianne Sasaki. Welcome to ThinkTech Hawaii, where some of the most interesting conversations in Honolulu go on. I have a show on Wednesdays from 1 to 2 called Life in the Law, where we discuss legal issues, politics, governmental topics, and a whole host of issues. I hope you'll join me.
We're back. We're live. We're here with Gavin Thornton of the Appleseed Center for Law and Economic Justice, and Roger Epstein, who is a tax attorney of many years. And we're talking about SB 648, which we've described as part of the tax revolution, and to clarify and resolve and make it more fair for the people in Hawaii, especially those who need help from the social safety net. So it's in the legislature, and you, along with the Hawaii Tax, what's a fairness initiative, are shepherding this bill, SB 648, through. How's it going, Gavin?
Surprisingly well, given that it's tax and such a dry issue. You know, taxes aren't something that people typically get fired up about, except to say that we need less of them. So it's going really well. This Hawaii Tax Fairness Initiative is a pretty broad coalition of groups that are interested in how low and moderate income people are struggling in Hawaii and what we can do to address that. So we just had our first hearing on the first bill out of the chute.
What committee was that?
That was in front of Senate Ways and Means.
Finance.
Senate Ways and Means. Yeah.
Senate Ways and Means.
And then we have the companion bill is up for hearing in front of House Finance tomorrow. Mm-hmm. At the Senate hearing, which I wasn't able to attend, but I know that Roger was, I heard that it took about 10 minutes for them to read through.
Oh, more than that. There were hundreds of people that testified in favor of it. And they weren't there. She just called off all the names, asking anybody if they want to come up and speak.
That's impressive.
As well as,
that's impressive.
But filed testimony, it took 10, 15 minutes to read
that
everybody's name.
That is a popular bill,
yeah.
For sure.
And everyone was in favor of it, with very few, maybe one or two. Some of the state organizations, the Tax Foundation, as well as the Department of Taxation, had some technical issues with it. But overwhelmingly, people were in favor of it. Now that's at the beginning of the process, as you well know. And I think people are going to be very concerned about raising tax rates. That's a big concern. But, you know, I go back to a period when I first started as an Internal Revenue agent in 1967, the tax rate federally had just come down from 90% to 70%.
The good old days.
I'm telling you. But people who were alive, you know, it didn't ruin business. I mean, those were the heydays in the 60s and 70s. And in the 50s, after World War II, things were going really well. And so when Reagan came in 1986, he put in a new tax, 1986 Tax Act, saying we're going to pay 35%, we're going to eliminate all the deductions, everybody's going to pay 35%, supply side economics, we're going to have more revenue because we reduced the tax law. Well, you see where we are. We're $20 trillion in debt, and we've got 1% of the country owning more than half of all the wealth. It's had a very bad effect. It doesn't work. And what we're going to hear from the Republicans are more of the same. They don't seem to care about the wealth gap. And so I think this is a Democratic state. 65% of the people voted for Hillary Clinton. And more are registered Democrats. So we have to decide, what do we believe? Do we believe it's every person for themselves? Or is the state going to turn and say, it's time for us to step up because the federal won't do it? This is a very, as I explained before, very sensible way because the feds actually pay some of the cost. And it's not that Hawaii has such a heavy income tax because they're already giving pensioners a huge break. And so,
it's not burdensome.
No, I think it's fair. And it's and again, you can make names, redistributing the wealth. We're not redistributing. Who should bear the cost of government? We got to have government. It costs money. Who should pay? The guys who are just barely putting food on the table, or people who have a lot of discretionary income.
And we're not talking about a tax rate of 90% here. We're talking about tax rates that apply to people that are pretty well off, joint filers that have a taxable income of $300,000 or more.
There's not that many of them.
There's not that many. So this affects, we think, about the top 5% and primarily the top 1%.
Yeah.
So $300,000 of taxable income is a lot more actual income. Roger could probably explain that more. I was looking at Mitt Romney's tax return. You know, I think he had about a quarter of his gross income off of, you know, deducted from his taxable income. So it's people that are making a lot, and the increase is significant, but it's not severe. So, for example, a joint filer with a taxable income of $350,000 would pay $375 more in taxes. As you go up from there,
it's
not going to kill you.
No. Yeah. Yeah. No. Well, how much have you figured out how much it's going to benefit the state treasury?
So with the whole package, not at all, because
it's going to go back to the low earners.
It's going to go back to the
low. So it's actually, as you said before, it's neutral, revenue neutral.
Correct.
But the total is, what's the total revenue raise?
So people are still trying to figure that out. Last year, when they were discussing the revenue raised, figures were around $48 million. We work closely with the Institute for Taxation and Economic Policy in D.C. By their analysis, this would raise as much as $70-plus million. So a significant amount. It could pay for even more than this tax relief for the low-income folks that we're talking about.
The state said $42 million. But mm-hmm. But just look at it this way. I mean, it's almost, I don't want to say laughable, but I'm making $350,000 a year, and you ask me to kick in another $375. So somebody who's working, we're not talking about people in the street, somebody who's working hard can put food on the table for his family for $375. This is why, when you look at how out of balance we've become, another example of it that's bothered me for years, when I first got in the tax business, if you got a dividend, you got a $150 deduction for your dividend. $150. Okay? Today, you pay 15% on your dividends. 15%.
Which is way cheaper than the marginal rate.
Way cheaper. The marginal rate at $100,000 of income, say there's two people working and they got a family, they're making $100,000. Their marginal rate is already 20% federal, 25, maybe 28% federal.
So this is a benefit for people with dividends.
Of course. So our law favors the guy sitting there clipping coupons against people who are out working.
That's really unfair.
And not only that, there's a Social Security tax, which, and Medicare. So that's another 12% that you pay on your gross income, no deductions. And so what are we thinking of? And then the Republicans, and this is, I'm really out in the open that I think the Republican philosophy is misguided and has taken us down a bad path. And now that they're in control of everything, it's liable to be worse. So I think we have to really step up and think about this as a state of aloha.
Yeah. And we have to be a leader.
We have to be a leader. We always were leaders years ago. And now, you know, Dan Inouye's not here, and we don't have some of those elder people. Some people are going to have to step up in the legislature.
Let's take a moment and give credit for the people in the legislature who are championing and supporting this bill.
Sure. So Miley Shimabukuro in the Senate is the lead sponsor on the Senate bill, and then Representative Johansson on the House side. Representative Johansson's actually someone that's maybe as excited about tax as Roger is, which is pretty rare.
Pretty rare. Nicole Wu is excited about that.
My colleague, Nicole Wu, yes. And so it's really good to see that in the legislature.
And Jay, let's say this. The legislature has a very difficult job. This is a huge problem. Yep. Nobody wants to raise taxes. Nobody, if you say, I voted to raise taxes, it's like, well, that's a strike against you right there. But this is a revolution. We have to look, what are we going to do? How many more people do we want to see not pay their rent, have kids not eating proper? All this is going to come back to haunt
us. We the people. We the people bill.
Yeah.
We have to pay attention to the taxes. We have to rationalize them. We have to make them fit to our society. We're almost out of time. Gavin, can you close? Well, talk to camera one there. Those are the people. And tell them what you want to leave them with.
Just the importance of an issue that's as dry as taxes in the lives of everyday people. This is a critical issue. It's affecting people every time they go to the store. And we need to change that balance, to give people a real fighting chance to make ends meet.
And Roger, 30 seconds.
30 seconds. I agree. We're out of balance. That's all. We're out of balance. We're going to get more out. We're going to get more out of balance. It's not healthy for the rich or the poor. This, to me, is just a start of what we're going to have to think about. It's a very, almost a no-brainer to me. But I really have enormous respect for the people of the legislature are going to have to make these hard decisions. But I think it's at the beginning, and more to come about how we have a society in an era where the United States generally is coming down and other people are coming up, and we have to make those hard decisions for ourselves.
You guys have to come back. You know, you have to come back and tell us how the bill does. You have to come back and tell us how you really feel, especially you, Roger. We need to know how you really feel. And finally, you have to come back so we can discuss Donald Trump's tax returns, because sooner or later we'll be able to see them.
You think we're going to get Donald?
No.